So we're coming to the end of the Psalms. We found this bunch of 8 Psalms of David from 138 to 144, and or 145 maybe it was, I'm not sure. And within that there was another set of 4 Psalms, all of which are prayers for help while David is in trouble. That's from 140 to 143. And I decided to do only 2 of them because they are similar themes. And what we can learn from David about prayer. So in Psalm 141, we learned that David first prays for his prayer to be acceptable and pleasing to God. Then his first petitions are for himself, deal with me. And then he says to deal with his enemies. And finally he says that he's waiting for God to answer his prayers. So that was what we did with Psalm 141. I just thought I'll revise it briefly. And Holy Spirit, we echo the prayer of the disciples to Jesus. Lord, teach us to pray. And we commit this reflection on the Psalm 142. Into your hands, Lord. Let us learn from David. In Jesus' name, Amen. Okay, Psalm 142. I'll take it in sections. First, it says, the title is a rather longer title. It says, A Maskil of David when he was in the cave, a prayer. So, that word, a maskil of David, that word maskil literally means a hedge. And it's an idiom. The meaning of this is that it is a didactic hymn or poem, which means it is meant to give instruction. And there are 12 other psalms that have a similar title. And so obviously, I mean, in Psalm 141, I said we can learn from David about prayer. In Psalm 142, which is again about prayer, it's almost as if David is himself teaching us about prayer, instructing us in something. Then it says, when he was in the cave, this is almost certainly 1 Samuel 22 verse 1. When he's running from Saul. I'll just read that out. Saul tries to kill David and then he escapes. And in 22 verse 1 it says, David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam. When his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him. And then of course we know famously all those who were in distress or debt or discontented went and gathered around him. Okay. And so the commentators pretty universally say either it was this time when he was in the cave, or there's another time in 1 Samuel 24 when again he's in the cave, he's in another cave at En Gedi. But it cannot be that second time, because he had many loyal men around him, and you will see from the context that this is a time when he is absolutely alone. And so just looking at the words, I would say that this is a time when he's escaped from Saul. He's come to the cave at Adullam before his brothers and other people and all those distressed and discontented join him. And he is really very much alone at that time. And it is a prayer. And of course, we'll continue to be instructed by David on prayer. So I've divided into a few sections. The first section is verses 1 and 2. Which is, what is the nature of David's prayer? I cry aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out my complaint before him. Before him I tell my trouble. And just looking at it, you can see different verbs which are used to describe his prayer. Okay. By now you should have an idea how to just look at a psalm and you can get the pattern from it. Okay. How is David praying? He says, first I cry aloud. And that is literally a loud and audible prayer. So even though he's all alone, you can imagine him in the cave all alone, crying out loudly to God. Okay, he says, I lift up my voice. And the sense of that is, he's lifting up his voice in the way that you are entreating and petitioning for mercy or favor. Okay, that is the sense of his lifting. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. He's entreating, he's petitioning. Okay, and we saw in 141 as well, and we see here also that he's in a desperate state. Okay, especially here when he feels all alone. He might have been strengthened later when people joined him, but here he's still all alone. The third one is interesting. He says, I pour out my complaint before him. Okay, that word complaint actually means musings or meditations. And so the point is this, that as he reflects upon his situation, he's musing about it, he's dwelling on it, and he has all kinds of feelings and thoughts and whatever. He says, I pour out my complaint, or I pour out my musing. He holds nothing back of what is on his mind. You know, he's venting or ranting or raving or agonizing, whatever he's feeling, whatever's happening inside him as he dwells on this or muses about this or meditates on his situation, he pours it all out. He doesn't hold anything back before God. Okay, and that continues with that. I tell him my trouble. That word tell actually means to make conspicuous. And so actually what he is doing is he is declaring the specifics of his situation. He is making it conspicuous. He is making it obvious in a sense. And I thought that probably means that he tells God specifically what he is going through. Okay. But the other thing that comes out very clearly here in each of those four lines is who. Twice the word the Lord and twice the phrase before him. You see, I cry out to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord. I pour out my complaint before him. I tell my trouble before him. He's, you know, God is looking for authenticity in our prayers, and that's what we find here with David. There's no need for pretense or false piety or bravado before him. No, God, I'm going to do this. I'm going to go through this in your name or whatever. David is feeling what he's feeling. He can pour it all out before the Lord. Okay. And of course the point is this, why tell God the specifics of my situation when God already knows it, no? He already knows what you're going through. So it's about relationship. It's always about relationship. And something that gets deeper and stronger in that process of communication, which is of course what prayer is. And God is really happy to listen to our pouring out, our venting, the specifics. Okay. He is really happy to hear all that stuff. Okay. The next is, as I said, David is being very specific, so David tells God what his troubles are. Verses 3 and 4. When my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who know my way. In the path where I walk, men have hidden a snare for me. Look to my right and see. No one is concerned for me. I have no refuge. No one cares for my life. So when my spirit grows faint, that word is overwhelmed. Okay, the literal meaning is covered. Something covers his spirit. So he says, God, my spirit is overwhelmed, it is growing faint within me. And when I read this, and actually I've been reading the next two Psalms as well, and again and again I'm so struck by the fact how much Jesus would have been influenced by David in that sense, because of course he was steeped in the Old Testament, and this is such an echo of what Jesus says in Gethsemane. You know, I'm overwhelmed with sorrow. Of course, the context was different, but the feeling was the same. His spirit was overwhelmed. His spirit is overwhelmed with what he is going through. But I love the next line, it is you who know my way. Okay. However, David knows that the Lord has the bigger picture. You see, he knows what David has done, where David has come from. And in that sense, he knows that David has not done wrong. He is not responsible for the circumstance. But also he knows where this is heading. He knows where the situation is heading. David doesn't know, and so he is so overwhelmed with the situation. He can't see what is going to happen next. But he says, God, you know my way. And then he goes on to describe some of the situation. He says, the enemy has laid traps for me. I don't know where they are. But in a sense, it's also comforting that it is you who know my way, because God knows where those traps are. And finally, he tells God how completely alone he is. So that's why I can't imagine this was at the next, in the other cave, where he had such loyal followers and warriors with him. He can't possibly be crying aloud to God with them around and telling God, nobody cares for me, when there are people who have left their comfort and safety and come and are following this fugitive. It has to be at that time when he is all alone. And of course he says, look to my right and see. That sense of right, the right hand was the place of strength, a place of power. Basically, there's no one to deliver me. There's no one to save me. Okay? No one is concerned about me. No one cares for my life. I have no refuge. So he pours out his situation, the specifics of the situation. And I thought that the main sense here, you know, in other times and prayers, his focus is on his enemies and what they are doing to him and how his life is in danger. But really, I thought when I was reading the psalm that sense of the cave and that isolation and that loneliness was so much at the heart of what David was feeling here, that he is all alone in this situation. It is dangerous outside, but inside also in the cave, he is so alone. Okay. Spurgeon writes this about the psalm, and he says it as an introduction. It could have been put anywhere else. I thought it was a nice place to introduce this line. He says, the gloom of the cave is over the psalm. And yet, as if standing at the mouth of it, the prophet poet sees a bright light a little beyond. And I thought that comes actually here in verses 5 and 6. David's hope. Okay, David's troubles and then David's hope. He says, I cry to you, O Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Listen to my cry, for I am in desperate need. Rescue me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me. And that word, I cry to you, O Lord, is the same in verse 1. I cry aloud to the Lord. And I thought to myself, that David's acknowledgement of God is as loud and expressive as his cry for help. You know, our prayers are so desperate, but often our thanksgiving is quite muted in comparison. But David's acknowledgement of who, and he's not even thanking yet, there's nothing to thank for, but just his acknowledgement of God in this situation when he's all alone, you know, it's like Spurgeon writes, it's like a bright light a little beyond the gloom of the cave. And what does he say to God? What does he acknowledge? He says, God, you are my refuge. And that's contrasting with what he has just said in the previous verse. I have no refuge. Yeah? And then he says, no. And that is true in the worldly sense, in the sense of people, and anything the world could give him to protect him. But he says, now God, you are my refuge. Okay, so God is his refuge. and therefore it means this: I can put my trust in you. Okay. Think of it, you are my refuge. If you emphasize refuge, I can put my trust in you. If you emphasize you, I have nowhere else or no one else to turn to. You. And I will turn to you. He is just acknowledging God as his refuge. He goes further. He acknowledges God as his portion. And I've shared this before. That is such a wonderful phrase when we say that, God, you are my portion. Okay? You see, think about this. David, at this point in time, has been deprived of all that is his portion actually. You see? And for doing nothing wrong. He has been deprived of all that he rightfully possesses. He was the commander of the armies, so he must have had a good house to stay in. He must have been fairly wealthy. He must have had the loyalty of the whole army at that time. Fame and glory, and rightfully so, because he was winning battle after battle. He had a wife, Saul's daughter. He had everything. He's lost it all. You see, he has no portion anymore. And he says, God, but you are my portion. And he says, not just in this, you know, sometimes we know that our reward is going to come in the afterlife. He says, no, not just in the afterlife, but in the land of the living. You are my portion right now. That means, it's not even that I'm going to get something good later. You know, but right now you are my portion. In the suffering, in the isolation, you are my portion. And therefore, when he says, God, you are my portion, it means God is sufficient. God is all that he needs. And then he continues to express his weakness. He says there, I am in desperate need. That word actually means I have been brought low. And of course, compare that to the height that he was in, as the commander of the army, as more beloved than the king himself. He says, God, I have been brought low and I desperately need you to rescue me from my pursuers who are stronger than me. So that is David's hope. And then finally in verse 7, we see David's desire. Set me free from my prison that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness to me. And so when he says, set me free from my prison, he sees the cave as a prison that he cannot escape from. Okay? And actually that phrase is, set my soul free. You know, not just his body, but in a sense his soul is trapped. His life is trapped and needs to be set free. And I thought sometimes we are in that place where, you know, how does it become relevant to our lives? We might not feel that we are in prison. Obviously we are not. Or even trapped in a physical circumstance, but we can feel as if our souls are trapped. And that phrase actually is, set my soul free. We can feel as if our souls are trapped, as if spiritually we are in a kind of prison, we are in a kind of bondage that we don't know how to get out of. And we are crying out to God to set us free. But why? Why does David desire this? That I may praise your name. Now of course he can praise God's name in the cave all alone as well. Therefore the implication is that, set me free that I may testify to what you have done for me. I may praise your name publicly. Okay. The thing that you've done for me. And as a result, when the righteous hear about your goodness to me, they will gather around me. So he also desires to be in the company of the righteous. We've seen earlier that he does not want to be tempted to be in the company of those who are not righteous. He desires the company of the righteous. He desires that fellowship. And he says, God, and so these are the two things he desires. He says that firstly, that I can praise your name for what you have done, but also because of your goodness to me, because people will see how good you have been to me, the righteous will gather about me. Therefore, he desires the company of the righteous. He desires that fellowship. And again, this is something that is so significant for us, because just look through the entire Bible, the Old Testament, the New Testament, whether it's Israel or whether it is the church, you know, fellowship is such an integral part of whether it was the Old Testament life of being God's people, or the New Testament life of being the church, being God's people, being called out, whatever it is, you know, fellowship is such a keen part of it, this company of the righteous. And we see David again and again saying he wants that, he doesn't want to go away from that. And it's something really that we should also be, and I know that's true because all of you are here early in the morning. It means you desire the company of the righteous. You desire their fellowship. And it's so, and God just invites us again and again into that place, you know, not just to fellowship with Him, but also to fellowship with each other. And we see David desiring that here, that I will praise your name and I will enjoy the company of the righteous. I just want to pray that we can pray like David. Lord, I pray for authenticity in our prayers, Lord. That we may know without a shadow of doubt that we can pour out everything, Lord. We can be, not that we can be, you want us to be as open and honest with you. Anyway, you know everything. We thank you, Lord, that you've given us prayer. You've given us this way, Lord, to deepen our relationship with you. You already know everything about us, Lord, but we get to know you. We get to acknowledge you. And I pray, Lord, that we may be able to say like David, God, you are our refuge. And even more than that, you are our portion. Just come, Holy Spirit, and seal this understanding of prayer in our hearts. Seal this acknowledgement of you. And deepen this relationship, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen.